there's a story about this king in Africa, and he had this really close friend from childhood. And the friend had this habit of looking at every single situation in life, whether it's positive or negative, and saying, "This is good." In fact, irritatingly saying, "This is good," about absolutely everything. Well, one day, the king and his best friend, his childhood friend, were out on a hunting expedition, as they would often do. And the friend would be the one who would load and prepare the guns for the king. Well, the friend had apparently done something wrong in preparing one of the guns, because after the king took a shot, it blew his thumb right off. Well, examining the situation, the best friend looked at it and said, "This is good." To which the king replied, "No, this isn't good. This isn't good. I just lost my thumb." And he got so angry at his childhood friend that he sent him to jail. A long time, actually. About a year later, the king was hunting in an area where he just knew better, and he should not have been much there. He should have avoided it. And as a result, there were cannibals that captured him and took him to their village. They tied his hands, stacked some wood, and set him up on a stake, and were kind of about to have him as dinner. But just as they were getting ready to start the fire, they noticed that the king was missing his thumb. Being superstitious, they never ate a person who was less than physically whole in their opinion. So they untied the king, and then they sent him on his way. And as the king returned home, he was reminded of the event that took his thumb and felt so bad for how he had treated his friend. He immediately went to the jail to speak with them and said, "You were right. It was good that my thumb was blown right off." And then he proceeded to tell his friend everything that had happened. And then he said, "So I'm very sorry for sending you to jail for so long. It was so bad for me. I hope you can forgive me." His friend said, "No, this is good." "Well, what do you mean, this is good? How can it be good that I sent you, my friend, to jail for an entire year?" To which he said, "Well, if I had not been in jail, I would have been with you. And right now, I would be dinner." The friend of this king knew the importance of finding good in even the worst situations. He knew the importance of thanking God for moments that might seem like there's absolutely no reason to give thanks. The people in Haggai's day, they were challenged because they weren't thanking God at all. They weren't thanking God in the good times or the bad times. They had neglected God. They weren't prioritizing God. Specifically, they weren't motivated to rebuild the house in Jerusalem, the temple in Jerusalem that had been destroyed. Now, to give you some background, this all took place around 2,500 years ago. It was at a time when it was really important for the Jewish people to worship God at the temple. They would make pilgrimages to the temple, but there was no temple. There was no place to gather, because years before, the Babylonians invaded the land, they destroyed the temple and Jerusalem, and deported the leading Jewish citizens off to Babylon. Well, many decades later, these Babylonians were defeated by the Persians, and the Persians had a very different policy. They freed people to go home, freed people to worship in whatever way they saw fit. And once the people returned from exile to Jerusalem, one of the first things they did, because they knew the priorities at that point, one of the first things they did was to lay the foundation for a new temple. But then there was opposition, and people started fighting, and then they put the project off and off and off. They put the rest of the project off for 8 years. They went about their private business, abandoned the temple, and didn't fight. urging people not to make God a backseat God, not to tell God, well, I'll get to this, I'll get to my spiritual life, you know, when I have a chance. Now, the neat thing is, Haggai's ministry happened all within 4 months. His entire ministry within 4 months. And an even cooler thing, and I listed these dates in your sermon note sheet, we know the actual dates of all 5 of his sermons. Now, obviously, he wouldn't have called it B.C. at the time, before Christ. We know it because of, just as the scripture opened this morning, you know, in this year of King Darius, etc., etc., and then we can figure out exactly when it was. August 29th, September 21st, October 17th, and 2 sermons, because I guess, you know, I don't know, as a pastor, 2 sermons a day sounds kind of exhausting, but he gave 2 on December 18th, and then he was done. You know, sometimes I actually wish the Bible was a little bit clearer about some things. But in this case, it's almost more than crystal clear. Now, to give you a broader perspective of when this all happened, with the rest of history, this would have been, if it would have been 14 years after Thespis won the first prize in Athens, and now we call those, you know, actors Thespians. Haggai preached his message exactly 1 year after the Buddha preached his first sermon. This would have happened 11 years before the Republic of Rome was founded. This all happened at a time with other events in history that we become either slightly aware of or well aware of. It's a very locked in history type of piece. But now more locally, for Haggai's people, there was a huge famine coming through Jerusalem. And so Haggai went to the high priest and the governor of Judah and said, this is all happening because we have ignored God. And he continued by saying, but if we look to God, God will again bless us. You know, we heard that in that reading that Dale read so well and pronounced the names exactly right, by the way, so great job on that. You know, when God said to Haggai, these people say the time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Then the word of the Lord came by the prophet Haggai saying, is it a time for you yourselves to live in your paneled houses? Well, this house lies in ruins. Consider how you live there. You have sown so much and harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but never have you filled. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. You earn wages that go into a bag of holes. In other words, the people had for many years really enjoyed the blessings that God had poured on them. But there was little thanks being given to God, and the blessings were beginning to slip away. This is kind of a common trait for us as human beings. But, you know, it's easy to forget the need for God when we think that all of our physical needs are being met. It's said that it's just as important to thank God in the good times as it is to help or ask for help from God in bad times. And in fact, even to find ways to thank God in bad times, even though it might be most difficult. But these people, again, were completely ignoring God, even though some of the people alive had very vivid memories of being in captivity and exile and how painful that experience was to have to have been pulled from their homeland. The good news is, through the preaching and encouragement of Haggai, they did reorient their priorities. Within 3 weeks of Haggai's first sermon, they started rebuilding the temple. 3 weeks. And for that, God said, I will once again bless you. The phrase we hear later in Haggai is, although you have not yet harvested any grain, grapes, figs, pomegranates, or olives, I will richly bless you in the days ahead. Now, it is an important aside, an aside that's very important to hear, that obedience to God in this case did bring prosperity. But we want to be clear that the Bible doesn't always say that you get prosperity from following God. The story of Job actually dramatically proves that we can be suffering even when we're most faithful to God. You know, Job lost his family, Job lost everything. You know, even next week we'll be talking about the book of Habakkuk. And Habakkuk was wrestling with his faith because everything was falling apart, and he was simply asking the question that temple that was expanded years later by King Herod, the one that Jesus would have gone to when he was a little boy, the one where he would have actually been eventually arrested right outside of. To give you an idea of this temple, it was about 30 by 90 feet, 2,700 square feet. I would guess that we're probably in a space that's a little bigger than that right here, 2,700 square feet. And yet it's been estimated that to rebuild that temple today with those materials, it would cost $4 billion. $4 billion. So when you hear us talk about how we need to do some work on our roof here, it's not going to cost $4 billion. But what does that actually tell us? That is how strong that revival was. That is how powerful the people turned back to God. They didn't just build God a shack. They built God a palace because their hearts turned back. They knew their priorities. So what does this tell us now as Christians? Well, Scripture tells us that we also are temples of the Holy Spirit, that we are dwelling places for God, and that we are of great value to God as the place where God's Spirit takes up residence. So when we talk about Haggai and his message that we don't want to neglect the temple and how the people put God in the back seat, we want to remember for ourselves that it's important for us to keep these temples going well and to allow ourselves to experience a spiritual revival, to allow ourselves to be filled with God and to affect the world for the better around us. We do it by continuing to pray to God in both the good times and in the bad. We do it by continuing to gather for worshiping God in the good times and in the bad. We do it by continuing to dive into the Scriptures, to read our Bible or hear the Scriptures as we're driving to work in the good times and in the bad, by serving God and our neighbors, even serving those people who we find so difficult to love in the good times and in the bad. We do it by continuing to connect with fellow people of faith in the good times and the bad. We do it by continuing to find ways that we can strengthen the work of God in this world in both the good times and the bad. When we do it in both the good times and the bad, that is how the priorities reorient. That is how we keep God in the front and don't just have God in the back seat when things are convenient or when it just seems like it's the right time. We as well have an opportunity to work and to build and enhance and even to clean up the